I know that without a shadow of a doubt. He knows where you're hurting. He knows where you're weak. He knows where you're failing. He knows where you're not committed. And He wants to strengthen that area of your life by ripping that mentality away from you and replacing it with the heart of God.
Hi, this is Pastor Ken from Vineyard of Hope in Osawatomie, Kansas. My prayer for you today is that God would touch your heart in a real and tangible way for a breakthrough in your life as you hear this message. Thank you for watching, and I want to give you a personal invitation to come and see what we're all about. The church information is at the end of this video. Now I hope you enjoy this message. God bless.
How many of you guys believe that you're truly free in Jesus Christ? Some of you are really, really convinced. I praise God for that. Yes. I love the Word of God and what He's given me. Now, I'm going to conclude in the next two Sunday nights. I'm going to conclude our breakout series because I felt like the content of this message and this whole series needed to be completed with an exclamation point. I know that we didn't go into it. Before I left on sabbatical, we weren't able to finish it because the Spirit of God was moving in a different direction and we did things a little differently. I'm cool with that. But God has put it in my heart that this is the congregation. You are the people that needed to hear this. And so tonight we're going to talk about breakout love, free your mind. Everybody say free your mind. If I'm going to preach on Sunday mornings for the next 6 weeks on the true definition of freedom and what it looks like, I want to encourage you to understand something, that the only way you will ever break out of the complacency and the different religious ideas that you have flowing through your mind that have perverted what God has for you is if you will free your mind and quit limiting God and putting Him in a box. Yeah. We keep telling God that He can't, and He said, listen, I can do whatever I want. But you don't understand. Wait, I created you. But you don't know what I'm going through. I got news for you. We're talking about God. How do we do this as humans? Are we that silly sometimes that we actually think that God doesn't understand? I mean, we do. We're hurt. We're broken. Matter of fact, we even think that people don't. So we think that we're really, really, all we are is completely isolated. We think that we're the only ones that ever. Did you know there's nothing unique to what you go through in your life? Somebody has experienced that same thing? Mm-hmm. Nothing new under the sun. But we feel like that when we're in the middle of it, right? We feel like we're in prison. We feel captivated. And I just want to encourage you to understand something. There's somebody who's been where you've been. There's somebody who's gone through you've gone, what you've gone through. And Jesus touched their lives, so why can't He touch yours? You got to quit thinking like you're thinking and start putting on the mind of Christ. If He can free me, He can free you. If He can free you, your kids are in good hands. If He can set the captives free in you, He can set them captive, or they're free in me. I could get crazy with that, but that's not the message today. Today it's breakout, free your mind. If we intend to have the mind of Christ, I believe that God has called His entire body, no matter what church you're from, no matter what you want to label yourself, the entire body of Christ, every believer that exists has been called to put on the mind of Christ. How do we do that? I'm glad you asked. The Word of God is going to show us today, amen? I wrote this. I said, if we intend to have the mind of Christ, I believe that we must free our minds. And for many, that simply means that we've got to learn to let go, let God, and break free from the prisons that we've created ourselves. Our own self-imposed death penalties are what we live in sometimes because we decide to believe a certain way. And so we fall into the spiritual death, the spiritual drought, all because we decided to take back our stinking thinking after God's delivered us and taken us to a new level. And so we isolate and we separate and we think that it's just for a season when in fact all you're doing is killing yourself spiritually and you put yourself in this little box limiting God yet again. And that's not what God has for you. He has a continued consistent growth for your spiritual life if you'll dare to believe Him the way He's created you to believe in Him. You're special. And I'm special. And sometimes I'm today special, but I'm still special. Because we're all that, we're created special. And the sooner we get that, the better. How many of you guys remember the definition of breakthrough? I'm testing you today. You better. Sudden, dramatic, important development and discovery. We know that God gives us breakthrough after breakthrough, sudden, dramatic, important developments and discoveries that grow us, that change us, that direct our path. But I want to assure you that none of those breakthroughs are so that you can sit and soak. They're also that you can break out. Now, I defined breakout last time I was here and I was teaching on the series, and this is what breakout means. Breakout means it's an escape, often by force, as of from prison. You've seen people break out of prison. You've seen them break out of forts and they tear everything down, right? How about your kids? They'll create a fort and a tent fort, and when they want to break out, they rip everything apart getting out, right? And it's a mess, and it's messy, and it's sloppy. But the idea is that what they were held captive by, they would go to extremes to get out of, right? Well, that's the first part of breakout. The second part is something that I really like, and I'm kind of attracted to this part. It's a widespread appearance of or an outbreak. How many of you guys know that we're supposed to be breaking out and look like an outbreak of love to people who need Jesus? Yeah. What do you mean? I want to be a rash. What do you mean? An outbreak is something that's contagious. And if I want to be a breakout kind of guy, I want it to be like a rash that breaks out all over the bodies of people who are infected by my charisma, my love, my passion for God. What do you mean? I want people to see Jesus in me so much and the freedom that flows in me that whenever they see me, they know I've been with Jesus. And they want to know what I got. They want to catch it. Right? See, a breakthrough is so that we can break out. We can break out lovers. And often we don't live in that capacity because of several reasons, but the biggest is because we still haven't figured out that we are no longer slaves. Amen? Amen. And so today I'm going to take you on a journey through the Word of God, and I hope you get what God has for you today. I'm going to read some scripture to show you that sometimes people are free, but not free at all. Well, we can go through the motions, though. You guys ever had people at church do the Pentecostal peak? Thank you, Jesus, I'm so free. Forget it. You guys aren't with me tonight. Are they really free to worship, or are they worried about what people think? I mean, people think they're free, but they're not free at all. And I'm going to share with you how dangerous that is for the mindset of a believer who's trying to put on the mind of Christ. Turn with me to Exodus chapter 1. I hope that you hear this. God, I rebuke the enemy and I plead the blood of Jesus over this place. Open your hearts tonight, church. Listen to this in Exodus 1 verse 6. So I'm going to take you on a ride. You guys are going to go on a ride with me. God's people, when they had that great... Who loves the book of Exodus? Come on, it's an exciting book. If you've never read it, you need to go and you need to study it. It's an amazing time where God's people, they're broken, they're damaged, and they find freedom and they find hope. And the next thing you know, they're here in this time where the great Exodus occurs and freedom from slavery becomes their reality. Amen? And so I love what happens here, but it's full of breakthroughs and then breakdowns. Breakthroughs and breakups. It's full of all kinds of craziness designed for them to break out and become what God's called them to be. It's the great Exodus. So in Exodus chapter 1, verse 6, I'm going to start reading, and I'm going to hope that you will hear something from this body of people. It says this, in time, Joseph and all his brothers died, ending an entire generation, but their descendants, the Israelites, God's chosen people, we all know this, right? Had many children and grandchildren. In fact, they multiplied. They multiplied. Remember, we're doing this together. They multiplied so greatly that they became extremely powerful. And they filled the land. But eventually a new king came to power in Egypt who had become, who knew nothing about Joseph, right? And what he had done. And it says this in verse 9. He said to the people, look at the people of Israel, how they outnumber us now and are stronger than we are. Now I'm going to paint a picture here. You have people living on somebody else's land. The Israelites living on the wrong land. And they're growing and they're multiplying and they're getting bigger and they're getting stronger. And now the Egyptians, they notice something about these people. And so all of a sudden they look at these people and they say, look, they're stronger than we are. So here's what the enemy does in verse 10. We must make a plan to keep them from growing even more. How many of you guys realize when you begin to grow, the enemy starts to manipulate a plan, put together a plan. He begins to really come up with some ideas on how to screw your growth up. And I said, screw your growth up from the pulpit. That's what he wants to do. He doesn't want you to grow up. So he begins to manipulate a plan, put a plan together. We see it here for God's people. They're growing and they're strong. And they don't even know how strong they really are, but the enemy sure does. And so he begins to put together a plan. It says this, he tells his people, if we don't keep them from growing and come up with a plan and war breaks out, they will join our enemies and fight against us. Then they will escape from our country. In verse 11 it says, so the Egyptians made the Israelites their slave. I think it's funny here. The Egyptians made the stronger people their slave. The only way this could have happened is if they got in their head. They saw that they were stronger than them, so they come up with a plan to capture them, to make them slaves. And I'm going to show you that it was all a matter of the mind. Are you ready for that? I love the Word of God. This is what happened. They will escape the country. So the Egyptians made the Israelites their slaves. They appointed brutal slave drivers over them, hoping to wear them down with crushing labors. Now let's look at that for a minute. They used brutality. They used control to take a stronger people and make them slaves. That means they begin to mess with their minds. They begin to treat them as less than. Have you ever seen a control freak treat something or somebody like an object to the point of control? It wouldn't matter if they're stronger than them or not. They will control that person by controlling their mind. Oh, I see it all the time in marriages and dysfunctional relationships. You'd be amazed at what I see as a pastor. It's amazing how somebody strong will put up with an abuse and eventually believe that they're weak when they've had it in them all along. Amen? That's what happened here. The enemy got in their minds. It says this, he was hoping to wear them down with crushing labor. Verse 13, we find this. It says, so the Egyptians worked the people of Israel without mercy. They made their lives bitter. Oh boy, the enemy is a slow, manipulative jerk. Let's get crazier. The people that the enemy uses are slow, methodical manipulators. They're being used by the enemy. Unfortunately, we don't get mad at the people. We shouldn't get mad at the people. We should know the spirit behind them is what we need to combat. But the fact is the enemy does use people. And he uses them to slowly manipulate, slowly cause dysfunction to creep up in your mind based on their dysfunctional thinking. And I just want to tell you something today. God wants to free you from that. You're not slaves in Jesus' name. Amen? So I'm watching this and I'm reading this, and you see that they knew they were stronger, so they said, let's come up with a plan. Hoping to wear them down, they made their lives bitter, forcing them to mix mortar and make bricks and do all the works in the field. The Bible says this, they were ruthless in all their demands. The enemy has no mercy when it comes to your potential. He doesn't want you to grow up. He would rather you die. And he starts by getting in your head. Watch, this was the life of God's people held captive. They were slaves and prisoners. And it was all because the enemy got in their brain. He started getting in their mind. They couldn't see that they were stronger. I wrote this. They were slaves, prisoners, living a life below the standard that God had for them as chosen people. See, they got in their head. 430 years, the Israelites were beaten. They were killed. They were forced to do things below the standards that were set for them as children of God. And this was their way of living. Generations had come and generations had gone under the bondage of slavery. Their minds kept them slaves. When the enemy saw their potential, he won. Can you imagine? Now their kids were actually save-minded, born into this dysfunction. What legacy were they leaving? Nothing. The enemy has no mercy when it comes to your potential. Amen? Everybody say, but God. So the enemy comes up with a plan and he says, we're going to make you slaves and this is how it's going to work. And this is where God steps in. And I'm just going to kind of cut this down because it's such a beautiful story. It would take forever for me to teach this all to you. Please read it. Here's what happens. God saw their bondage and their pain and he decided to save them from slavery physically. Everybody say physically. So we see that he sent Moses to lead them out. Their breakthrough was about to become a breakout from their slavery. And we find this in Exodus chapter 3, verse 7. It says, and the Lord told him, and I want you to hear this. He told Moses, he said, I have certainly seen my people. I, God. I have seen the oppression of my people in Egypt. He tells Moses, I have heard their cries of distress because of the harsh slave drivers. Yes, I am aware of their suffering. Did you know God knows when you're going through something horrible in your life? I mean, he created everything. He knows. He knows when you're hurting. He knows when you're happy. He knows everything going on. And so here he is. He says, I've come to rescue them. I, God, have come to rescue them from the power of the Egyptians and lead them out and the Egyptians into their own fertile. He said, I'm going to lead them away from the Egyptians into their own fertile and spacious land. He was saying, I've got a blessing. I'm going to pull them out. I've heard their cries. I know they're in pain, but I'm God, and I'm going to do something here. What's amazing about this is then he decides to tell Moses, but I'm going to use you. Yeah, I think that's neat. Moses thought he got away with something, murdering somebody. He didn't get away with it. He got caught. Somebody saw him. He used somebody who had lived a life that was below the standards of God's children too. We don't want to touch that. That's too far into this. I don't want to go there today. This is what happened. He said, so I've come to rescue them from the power of the Egyptians and lead them out of Egypt into their own fertile and spacious place. It says it is a land flowing with milk and honey. We all know I need less honey, maybe more milk. I don't know, but it was a good place. That was funny. You can laugh. God is good. Verse 9, look, the cry of the people of Israel has reached me, God says, and I have seen how harshly the Egyptians abuse them. How did they get into the mind of these people who were stronger? Through a constant barrage of abuse and things that caused them to believe that they were actually damaged goods. This sounds like most people in Osawatomie, Miami County, and all of Kansas. We're all caught in this place where we think the lies of the enemy is the truth, and the reality is, no, it's not. God is bigger than all that junk. When are we going to believe that we're worth something? When we do, we're going to act like it. We'll quit getting the scraps and we'll start eating at the table. I can't wait to see some of you go there. Here's my point. God heard the cry and he said to Moses, now go and lead my people out. You must lead my people, Israel, out of Egypt. I want you to see something. God said, I'm doing the work, but you're doing the leading. And he sent Moses. In Exodus, we find that the breakout is about to occur. They had breakthrough after breakthrough because one plague after the other, there was a breakthrough after each plague. And all of a sudden, Pharaoh finally had the one point where all the firstborn of Egypt died, and he had had enough, and he's about to let them break out of prison, break out of slavery. This is their breakout moment right here. Watch this. In Exodus chapter 12, we see the great Exodus takes place. In verse 31, Pharaoh sent for Moses. This is after the firstborn was killed. And he says to Moses and Aaron, he sends for them during the night, and he says, get out! He's had all these plagues take place, and he's finally at the point where enough is enough is enough. I believe your God is God. Get out of here. And so he calls them and he says, get out. He ordered, leave my people and take the rest of the Israelites with you. He finally gave them what God said he was going to supply, which was their freedom. This is their breakout from slavery, their breakout from prison. Amen? Better than that, he said this, go and worship the Lord as you've requested. Take your flocks and the herds, as you said, and be gone. But this is the greatest place. But when you go, please bless me as you leave. I love that part because I find it amazing that the people that will torture you, call you no good, and break you down, eventually when they see God working in your life, are going to be the very ones that are going to come running into your heart. You think I'm crazy? I've had some of the worst people that I've ever worked with that have called me everything in the book come back because I have stayed consistent in my ability to love. Amen? And they said, bless me. Yeah, I can't, but he can. Anyway, this is what happened. But bless me. Bless me when you go. Go and worship the Lord. Take all the flocks. And verse 36, it said, how many of you guys know when God sets you free, he does it right? So if it's not what you thought it was going to be, it's because you did something wrong, not God. Watch this. This is how he delivered them. The Lord caused the Egyptians to look favorably on them and the Israelites. This is verse 36. Favorably on the Israelites. And they gave the Israelites whatever they asked. So the Egyptians gave the Israelites whatever they asked. So they stripped the Egyptians of all their wealth. Now you got to hear this. So God delivers them, but not just with the clothes on their back, with all the wealth, with all the gold, with everything that they had to offer, with everything that they needed, not just for the ride and for the journey, but for when they get there so they could settle. God did it right. He blessed them abundantly. He caused them to have such a great favor of the Lord on their life that when he set them free, he set them on the right path, setting them up for something beautiful. That's what God does. And so their breakout was beautiful and it was amazing. And God supernaturally did so many crazy things in their life. You've got to hear the word here. It was neat. So God freed his people from slavery, right? From bondage, from murder. And they left physically free. And in one translation, it says that they left with their fists raised in defiance. My God has set me free. Woo! I'm losing my voice or I do that loud. I mean, that's how they left. I'm going to paint a picture for you because I want you to see the truth of the dysfunction in some of this, okay? What an exciting time that would have been. Who agrees? 430 years, and they were finally set free. and their kids and their loved ones, and everybody was leaving this torture, this trauma. And not just leaving, but leaving rich. And they left with their fists raised and they took off. But tonight I want to assure you that freedom is not just being outside the walls of captivity. Amen? True freedom, I believe, goes a lot deeper. If you're not free here, you're not free here. I'll prove it. We can have breakthrough that never becomes a breakout. And we can never break out and live in the dysfunction of our thinking, which means we can be free but still in prison. I know a lot of people who say they're free, but I know a lot of people that are in jail that are more free than you could ever be. You know, what are you saying? Most are stuck in the prison of their own minds. I've gone to church with prisoners who are having revival that are locked up and experience the presence of God in a way that is so tangible and palpable that I've walked into some churches and begged God to let me get out of there. You can be free, not free at all. God took the people out of Egypt, but it took 40 years to take the Egypt out of the people. Because they were free, but they weren't really free. Watch this. How do you know that, Pastor Ken? What are you trying to say? I believe God positions his people for his glory. See, you want to know what real freedom looks like? When a little pressure is added and you've experienced the goosebumps on your duck pimples and you've accepted Jesus into your life and a little pressure is added, that's when we really see if you're free or not. That's when you begin to see if you're really walking in freedom and walking in spirit, or if you're still prisoners, captive by your own dirty and stinking thinking. This is when we really know where the rubber meets the road. Do you really live in freedom or not? Because you add a little pressure, and people who look free, who act the part, who raise their fists in defiance, sometimes turn into absolute chaos and dysfunction, revealing that they're not free at all. You don't believe me? Let's read this. This is the event in Exodus chapter 40. What happens is we see that God says to Moses, he says, now I want you to take your people now that you're free, and you're going to go camp between this point and this point. Ken is paraphrasing, so I don't have to read it all. And he says this. He says to Moses, he says, I'm telling you to go there because I'm going to harden Moses' heart, or Pharaoh's heart. I'm going to harden his heart, and he's going to come for you. He's going to think you're confused, but I'm setting you up so I can show my glory to Pharaoh and his armies once and for all. He's telling Moses, he says, I want you to come to this point. I want you to camp at this place. I'm going to harden the heart of this guy that used to be your slave master. I'm going to harden him and all of Egypt's heart. They're going to come after you with chariots. They're going to try to take you back. But I'm going to show that my glory is omniscient, all present. I am the Alpha, the Omega. I'm going to show that I'm God. And he wasn't trying to show the Egyptians or the Israelites this. He said, I'm going to do this because I want to show the Egyptians that I'm God. See, the Israelites should have known enough by now after seeing him work in all these wonderful ways. Right? They should have been believers, no doubt. But here's what happened. You had a little pressure. God says, go and camp, and this is what happened. It says, as Pharaoh approached, in chapter 14, verse 10, as Pharaoh approached, the people of Israel looked up and panicked. What do you do when a little pressure is added to you after you've already experienced freedom in Christ? That'll tell you whether you're free or not. How do you act or react? See, this time, they saw their past coming to creep up and wipe them out. And instead of understanding all of what God had already done to get them that far, they were so focused on the man of the God, not the God of the man, that they began to cower and they panicked. They revealed that they really weren't free at all. This is what happened. They panicked when they saw the Egyptians overtaking them. And they cried out to the Lord, and they said to Moses, everybody say Moses. Why did you bring us here to die in the wilderness? Now, if you remember when I first started reading, God said, I'm going to do this, and you're going to lead. Moses didn't kill the firstborn. Moses didn't cause the plagues. Moses didn't do all the supernatural things and intervene in a supernatural way. Moses was a man. He was leading as God was providing the glory and the power and the strength and the abilities. All he did was lead. And when a little pressure came, they forgot that their focus should have been on the God that delivered them, not the man that brought them that far. So their slave thinking, their slave mentality led them to point their fingers at a man rather than think about the God that brought them this far. See, if they were really free, they would have said, oh my gosh, here he comes, but God, you did it before, and I know you're going to do it again. Amen. They couldn't think that way because they were still slaves here. My point. Breakout means to think like Jesus, to live like Jesus, to believe that your Father can and will and is going to continue to do a good thing in your life. That He doesn't free you to get you all slave. The Bible says He who begun a good work in you is going to continue it until the time you see Him again. So a lot of us run around and we act like slaves because we don't have our mind on Jesus. We don't have our heart on Jesus. We keep thinking about all that He offers, not who He is. Right? Put a little pressure on somebody and their freedom or lack thereof really begins to reveal itself. They blame the man when it's the God. You know, people I had walk out of this church because they wouldn't go any further with their faith and blame me. It's not because they're bad people. It's because they continue to live like a slave and they didn't like the truth that was being taught. The power to free them is what they rejected, not me. But they had to have something tangible to blame. Because that's the mind of a slave. So what is a slave? It's a servant. That is the mind of somebody who serves self and flesh above their God. Or they make self and flesh their God. And they forget they don't have to serve that. It's not a Ken thing. It's a God thing. It's not a Nikki thing. It's a God thing. We've got to free our minds to begin to believe the word over our circumstances. If God saved your life, quit running from your salvation. Quit acting like a slave or a servant, if you will, to the things that used to ruin you and accept this love of freedom. These guys been getting the cower, and I think it's crazy because in that moment of stress, in that moment of chaos, they acted like baby Christians. And a lot of us have been in church long enough to know you're not a baby Christian after 5 years at Vineyard of Hope. I'm sorry. We preach the word here, and the only way you would still be a baby is if you didn't eat any of the meat. No. Time to grow. Why? Because He loves you. Right? See, we go from milk to meat. Bread, meat. I'm a carnivore, rawr. My kid used to say that when he was little. He'd run around, Daddy, I'm a carnivore, rawr. Anyway. We got to grow up, amen? Because that's true freedom. And growing up doesn't mean that you're perfect. Growing up means that you know who to run to. I run to my daddy. I'm a grown-up running to my Father. Because I know He loves me. I know that my strength is when I abide in Him, when I dwell under the shadow of the Almighty. I know it's when I remain, which dwell means main. When I remain in His love and I remain seeking Him, then I know that that's the answer to my dysfunction. And I don't start blaming people because I'm going through hell, and I don't blame God for the choices of others who are hurting me. Instead, I just abide. I begin to rest in Him. I begin to hold Him. I begin to believe that His word is true no matter what I'm going through. See, that's what growing up is about. That's what stepping out of slave mentality and putting on the mind of Christ is. It means I'm going to believe my daddy over anything you could say to hurt me. I don't care, man. People are going to be lost in your life. I don't care who's going to die in my life. I know my daddy got it. Y'all, this is weird, isn't it? It's freaky. You talking about daddy and stuff like that and love. Yeah, because it's what frees me. If we would just stop running and blaming and pointing fingers and getting scared and panicking when trials come and trauma comes and just let God be God and trust that He's going to work it all out, then He's going to work it all out. He says, I give you the desires of your heart. Isn't that beautiful? Slaves think like slaves because they serve self. You don't need to be a slave to your flesh anymore. God says, now you're a slave to Him. That means you're a servant to Him. Why? Because He wants to control you? Again, I say, no. When you're serving Him, that's where you find freedom. Unrestricted, untethered, relentless, out of control, chaotic freedom that looks like something. I preached that this morning. If you weren't here, get on YouTube when it gets out. Enjoy it. Share it. Get saved. Walk in freedom. Walk in freedom. It's cool stuff. I'm going to read this because I think you need to hear this. I know that some of us are like, man, Pastor Ken's, you don't understand what I'm going through. And can I just say, because I know I hear that screaming. Some of you act like I don't know a dang thing about what you're going through. And the truth is, maybe I don't, but I don't care. I don't have to. I do know that he does. I know that without a shadow of a doubt. He knows where you're hurting. He knows where you're weak. He knows where you're failing. He knows where you're not committed. And he wants to strengthen that area of your life by ripping that mentality away from you and replacing it with the heart of God. Now, I wish people would get it. I'm not passionate because I'm crazy, cool, nuts, and awesome. I'm passionate because he first loved me. That's why I preach the gospel today. He loves me enough to free me forever. I don't deserve it. You don't either. I'm going to burst your bubble. You're not that cool. But he still loves you. If you knew what I did, and he still let me preach the gospel. If you knew what I've been in my life, and he still lets me speak life into people and lead them to Jesus and to hope, that he would afford me the freedom that I live in today baffles me. It blows my mind that there's that kind of love that exists in this crazy world. I don't get it. I don't understand it. I'm so jacked up, I don't get it. God, why me? Why? And you know what he says? Because you dare to quit thinking like a slave. He continues to grow me because I'm not going to take scraps anymore. Yea, though I walk through the valley of death, I will fear no evil. He prepares a table before me in the presence. I'm not sitting on the floor and I'm not taking scraps. I'm going to sit at the table and I'm going to let him wow my enemies. Yeah. Come on, you guys. You guys know this is good preaching. Yeah. I'm going to preach to myself. The only reason some people don't live free from their hurts, their habits, their hang-ups is because they don't actively pursue Jesus. Jesus be the center of it all. Who remembers that song? Jesus be the center of it all. I don't remember all the words. I just know I want him to be the center. Because nothing else matters. That's where freedom is found. It's found in him. And that's why he says, come on. He says, come on, have the same attitude as I do. Are you a follower of Christ? Because if you are, freedom is right there. If you're not, that's why freedom is not there. I told you this morning, choose today who you're going to serve. Freedom is found in choosing today who you're really going to serve. I want to read this. This is funny. This isn't funny, actually. It's pretty sad that people would be so broken mentally to be at this point. And the only reason I can say this like I do is because this does sound like me whenever I was broken and battered and torn up. I had this kind of mentality. Think about this for a minute. They said this to Moses. Why did you bring us here to die in the wilderness? Weren't there enough graves for us in Egypt? What have you done to us? You know, I blamed my parents. I blamed everybody. I blamed people who hurt me for the fact that I wanted to stay broken when in fact I just wanted to rationalize my compromise. Anybody else? It's just me because I'm the only one. Listen, I've been there. And this is what they're doing here. They're trying to, what have you done to us? Why did you make us leave Egypt? They left with their fists raised in defiance and they took all the wealth with them. And they're sitting there looking at Moses going, why did you make us leave? Oh, we won't touch that. Here's what they said. Didn't we tell you this will happen while we were still in Egypt? We said, leave us alone. Let us be slaves to the Egyptians. It's better to be a slave in Egypt than a corpse in the wilderness. They were saying, I'd rather die in bondage. I'd rather die a drug addict. I would rather die porn addicted and in a place where I don't know true intimacy. I would rather die consumed by the slavery of this flesh. How sane is that thinking, really? Think about it. I don't know about you, but I would rather die free. I would rather die knowing that my heart is set on seeking Jesus. I'm not going to die perfect. I'm a dude. But I will die trying. Trying to live in the presence of the Almighty and the freedom that He affords me. I'm going to die trying. I'm going to die trying to live in the boundary set for this covenant of my marriage. And I'm going to live in the shadow of the Almighty, and I'm not going to let anything come past my eye gates that could ruin this intimate walk. Because that's freedom. The only reason I love my wife right is because I don't watch pornography. Ooh, we're touching on touchy stuff. It's got to be that fanatical. The only reason I don't cuss at work anymore, well, it'd be at church now. The only reason I don't cuss is because I don't watch cussing. I had to walk out of a movie the other day and waste my money. Because it was cussing too much for my brain. Should have looked at the rating before I paid. Dum dum. It's that fanatical. To live in freedom means I have to sacrifice flesh. But isn't that what Jesus did? Mm-hmm. But he could have called 10,000 angels. Breakout freedom means free your mind to live like Jesus. Free your thinking to walk like Jesus. He is everything in all things, and in Him there is peace that passes all understanding. In Him there is such an awakening to what the reality of true love looks like that you can live joyful in all circumstances. People ask me, again I say all the time, why are you happy all the time? And I tell them I'm not happy all the time, but I'm about 99% happy all the time. You got 1% that I miss, but 99% is authentic because I know in whom I trust. I love Jesus. You're a freak, you're a fanatic. Yes. I was that crazy for my dope. Why not Jesus? He was that fanatical for me. Oh my gosh. You want to call me a fanatic? Let's look at the Jesus we serve. And what He took for us. That's fanatic. That's real. Don't tell me it's not going to cost you nothing to be a Christian. It should cost you everything. Not because you have to, but because when you understand His love, you want to. You want to. I'm like a bottled up, ready to explode, crazy, nutty, filled with the Spirit kind of guy right now. You guys don't even know. In me, I just want to grab you, and I want to grab you by your ears, and I want to look you in the eye, and I want to tell you, open your mouth, and I'm going to scream at you, and let all the words fill your heart. Till you realize how loved you are. I know that's weird. I know. Some of you, you're so hard-headed, I just want to grab you by your ears, and I want to pinch your nose, and I want to just scream at you and hold you and tell you, I love you, and so does Jesus. But I don't know even if that's going to get through. Why? Because I want you to understand what God has for you is so much better than what the world offers. And the only time you're going to believe that is if you quit thinking like you do. You're so loved, Anita. Did you know that you are so loved and highly favored, Miss Anita? You are loved by the King of Glory. And when He sees you, He sees beautiful. He sees purpose. He sees passion. When He sees you, He sees the reflection that looks just like Him. I think it's nuts that God would make us in His image, and we think that means our physical image, that I look like God. No, He's talking about the characteristics of the name of God. Name is His nature. He created you to look like love and hope and peace. And the world has decided to make you think that you're slaves. And you believed it. Stop. You're not an addict. You're a born-again man of God. And the devil keeps trying to rip you from your victory. I rebuke that in the name of Jesus. You are a son of God. You are free. He whom the Son sets free is free indeed. Some of you, I love you so much, and I just can't stand you not loving yourself. nuts, isn't it? You're a daughter of the King. And he misses you. So do we. You think I'm nuts?
Yeah.
I'm in love. Why? Because I know what it means not to be a slave anymore. That doesn't mean I know perfection. That means I know grace. That means I understand mercy. It means I don't deserve none of this. But he still loves me. And I get to share it with you. I wrote this. I said, why blame Moses when they are now physically free? Why blame Moses? How sick and broken is your mind if you believe that living or dying in abuse is truly the way to go? Living and dying out of the freedom that God has afforded you is actually an option. That means that you really need healing here. To actually believe that lie means the enemy is still trying to kill, steal, and destroy what God has ordained for greatness. There are so many that are physically free, but not free at all. And now they sit in their wealth and their prosperity when even that wasn't enough to keep these people from thinking. They were rich and still slaves. I'm not talking about freedom. You're going to be rich and glorious in prosperity. You know that giving is not God's way of raising his budget. It's his way of raising his children to be like him. I'm free. I tithe. No, you do that because that's God's. You're free when you give because you want to look like him. Well, I read my Bible every morning. What did you learn from it? These are one of those things. Well, I'm walking on the Word of God. Well, open it while you're walking on it. There's the power. Well, if it's God's will. Well, it's God's will. Is it yours? Some of the things I've heard. It's his will that you live in freedom. Yeah. I wrote this. I said you can be locked up and free, or free and still locked up. And that's what I call a self-imposed death penalty. Spiritually dead, walking dead. There are zombies that live today, and they are the spiritually dead that walk around in and out of church, never experiencing intimacy in true worship. Never experiencing intimacy when his word comes alive and transforms your thinking. Never experiencing all that God has, but you're walking into church, and you're walking into the church, and you're doing this. And you're walking home, and you never leave changed, and you want to blame the pastor. He must be doing something right. The music wasn't good enough. It was too loud. It was too quiet. None of that even matters. Did you come to see God? Because if you came to be met by Jesus, he'll meet you.
Amen.
Freedom isn't in all the things and the gimmicks. It's just in Christ, and you daring to believe him over your circumstance. This is the point of my whole message. Freedom comes and it goes. Freedom goes beyond the physical and the natural freedom. True freedom is supernatural because it exceeds the natural. True freedom is supernatural because it occurs in our minds, so it's like living in faith. We have to actually have it take place here and then it becomes tangible out here. That's real freedom. When you can believe it, you'll become it. People think I'm nuts. You want to be a millionaire? Hang out with millionaires, right? You want to be free? You want to find Christ? Hang out with people who are free and walking with Christ. Begin to grow together. Begin to do what God's called you to do, and you'll find that. I have a cousin, and I'm telling you, he didn't go to school to be a builder. He didn't go to school to do any of that nonsense. He didn't go to school for anything, and he wanted to do this, and he had some money, so he started going to a coffee shop and listening to all these millionaire builders and their conversations and asking them questions on how they did this, how did they structure their business. Next thing you know, he just sold one of his things for $500,000, paid $200,000 to pay off the 200-acre land lot for their new church that they're going to build. Because he said, I decided for once in my life I was going to go be with the winners and the people who knew what they were talking about so that I could begin to win in my life. When he built his home, he opened the Word of God that talks about tithing and giving. And he set it in the concrete. And he said, people that walk into my house, and he had it poured over in concrete. People that walk in my house are literally standing on the Word of God. Not because he'd ever read it, because he studied it and he knew the truth in it. Yeah? You want to do this? You want to be a winner? Let's start acting like it and being with winners. I didn't say perfect people. You go to church, there's going to be dysfunction. Praise God, it's everywhere. I don't care what denomination. Church is a hospital. If you go to a perfect church with perfect people, it's a cult. Get out. The Kool-Aid is coming. Right? That's funny. I don't care who you are. But I would encourage you, until you found out what freedom looks like, and until you've really, really grasped this, we're preaching on freedom for a while. I believe God, like we said earlier this evening, Pastor Brenda, I think that God is setting us up through this series of messages for a really amazing and profound impact that he wants to make spiritually in our lives for the next season of our ministry here. And if you will grasp with your head and your heart completely what it means to be free, just imagine the effect that you're going to have on your work environments and your families. You'll quit looking at the man of God and start looking at the God of the man and get a lot farther. Amen? God is so good. My point is this. Has slavery or captivity become so comfortable to God's people that while facing turmoil or conflict, we forget that we are free even if the walls of our own prisons try to cave in on us? What do you mean, Pastor Ken? There are so many prisons that we live in. Our prisons are fear, guilt, torment, anger, rage, addiction, insecurity, unforgiveness. They're all matters of the mind that can be remedied if we change our mind. If we allow God to change our mind. These are no longer our masters, brothers and sisters. We are slaves to nothing or nobody but God because we choose to serve Him and Him alone. And that's where it's all found. Fear is a self-imposed death penalty. Doubt is a self-imposed death penalty. Do we want to live like the walking dead, or do we want to walk alive? Well, that depends on what you serve. So I'm going to challenge you to walk in freedom tonight. Choose tonight who you're going to serve. The God of the man or men. Because there's still freedom in Jesus Christ. Amen? Amen. I have so much more. I could preach for 2 hours on this. But some of you are like, no, I have a Twinkie at home. I'm sorry, that's just me. Isn't it good to be in the house of God? Amen. Don't be slave-minded. These people experienced supernatural event after supernatural event, and God still called them His chosen people. Still does to this day. And they failed to recognize that it was God doing all this, not men. I don't want you to make that mistake here. That's what we thought was so beautiful about our sabbatical. You guys were here because you're not following Ken and Missy. This is the home that God's got you in. And so the Spirit of God presented Himself here with or without us. But now that we're back, can we just get crazy, fanatical, faithful again? Can we go a little deeper? Can we experience freedom together? I want you to pray and seek God this week that God would reveal to you what you're not free from so that you would be brave enough to put it in His hand again. Quit taking back what He's already taken from you. If you let it go, let it go. If you've left it right there, quit taking it home with you. It's His. And I get so irritated with people who would do this. You know the Bible says that once you've given your life to Jesus, you've been washed white as snow. The old has passed away, behold, all things become new. I get so mad at people who continue to live back there in their slave mentality because they're talking to God about this stuff and He's going, I don't know what you're talking about. I wiped that clean. Why do you keep calling yourself that? Why do you keep acting like what you were? I don't even know what you're talking about. You're hidden in my Son. I love you. Stop it. When you can get what I'm trying to say there, you'll start living in freedom. Amen? I can tell you right now, I'm going to make mistakes, but I'm not going to hang out and kick my own butt. That hurts. I'm going to walk in freedom. Will you join me? Because whatever God wants to do depends on us living free. without compromise, without fail. What God wants to and is doing, let me reword that, is because we would dare to live the freedom he has. Not for us, but so people can see it works. So people can see he works. You are the only gospel somebody's going to read one day. And if they don't see the truth and freedom, they won't read the gospel again. Amen? So I know this is going to be weird. I'm going to be diving in. I'm going to be bugging you. Some of you guys, I'm going to stretch you. Some of you are going to, I promise, I can't get it, I promise. You're going to get mad at me. No. When I preach this gospel for the next few months. But I guarantee you that after you get mad and get over yourself, you're going to get happy and understand that it's because I love you. That was good. I don't care who you are. Would you stand with me?